motivated.
Get motivated.
Get motivated. Hip hop motivated. Blowing wisdom on the mic with Sean.
Gentlemen, it is time to get motivated. Welcome to Hour 2, Flow of Wisdom Radio. Yours truly, Sean Anthony. Again, my website is flowofwisdom.com. And we do this show live every Sunday, 3 to 5 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. I'm very excited to bring on my next guest. Well, my first guest, actually. Do it all. He's one-third of the legendary platinum-selling hip-hop trio, Lords of the Underground. They gave us classics like Chief Rocka, Funky Child, and so many more. He's also an actor. We're going to talk a lot about that and his philanthropy in the community in Newark, New Jersey. But it's an honor to have you on the show. Do it all from Lords of the Underground.
Yeah.
Duke Kelly, how are you, sir?
Oh, man, I'm great. It's a beautiful Sunday, you know, and evening and early evening in Newark, New Jersey, man. I'm feeling good. How you guys doing?
Doing wonderful, man. I'm doing wonderful. You know, I met you briefly a few years ago. You came here. My show is based out of Richmond, Virginia. It's syndicated, but I do this show here in Richmond, and you came here for one of our, Anyway, it was a big concert, and you came, and you guys rocked it.
Oh, I think I remember that.
Uzi D.
Yeah,
Jeff Anderson.
I mess with Richmond, man. I like Richmond a lot, man.
Yeah. So, man, I have a lot of questions for you, man. But you know, by your social media, you're very active within your community in New Jersey. Because there's some historic questions I want to ask you too about hip hop and how you got in the game and all of that stuff. But one of the things that really resonated with me, I follow you on Instagram and I check you out, man, and I really love what I see. But you have a nonprofit organization called 211 Community Impact that focuses on literacy. One, what prompted mm-hmm. you to launch this program, and what specifically does the organization do?
I can't take all of the credit for that for our nonprofit organization. The organization 211 Community Impact was founded by myself, by my partner Eon Haynes, and by our former executive director, Dr. Lauren Wells. And I stay doing things in my community. You know, I just feel like if I don't give back to the city that I claim to love so much, that I wear on my hats and clothes and shirts and jumping around on these stages, if I don't give back to what I believe that made me, then how will something ever grow better than I am, you know what I mean, from the same, you know, earth, you know, from the same situation, from the same city. And I was already doing a lot of things in my community even before Lords of the Underground. And when I met Dr. Lauren Wells, who was a big advocate for literacy and education, we just started talking about some things that I was doing in the community, that we were doing in the community, and what made better sense to attack and inform the community. What kind of nonprofit organization should we form? And we kind of all agreed that when you make people aware of different policies and the things that are privy to them that they don't know about, then that's what we should do. And we just came up and said, let's make our nonprofit about literacy, because everybody needs to be literate in some kind of aspect. Because when you receive more information and you know better about the information that you receive, you do better. So we formed it around literacy and impacting the community.
That's awesome, man. And it needs to be commended. It just needs to be brought more in the forefront on what you're doing. And I applaud you for that, man. You know, I grew up,
man.
No doubt. I grew up in South Jersey. And of course,
word up, South Jersey.
Yeah. And
still Jersey, baby. I'm really trying to break the chain from everyone saying North Jersey and South Jersey, because I always believe that New Jersey is a state divided. And if we can break that divide, this state will be such a powerful state, man.
That's true. You know, the only reason why I say it is because when I say it to others, they're not from Jersey, or haven't been to Jersey. They equate Jersey to New York. They think that, you know, whenever you say Jersey, oh, right across the bridge from New York. No, I'm actually grew up across the bridge from Philly. So
Philly, yeah, no doubt.
Camden, to be precise. Mm-hmm. But nonetheless, I was fortunate enough, Dupree, to you know, have blessed parents that shielded me from the environment of Camden, New Jersey. And I made it out and became successful and had a career. Likewise with you, Newark, you know, that's North Jersey. It's still Jersey. But, you know, you became successful and made it out. What were the things that you did or your influences that helped you get out of the trap, if you will, that most black men would normally get caught up in growing up in Jersey?
I think what helped me make it out, man, is wanting better, wanting more, knowing what the good people and the good that this city generates and produce, but a lot of times get overshadowed by the negativity. You know, a lot of times what fuels me is the underdog, or the thing that fuels me is when you try to turn something, you know, I love turning a negative into positive, showing that there's good inside of everything. Sometimes it's just circumstance and situational things that make people, you know, one mistake can negate all of the good that you've done. Mm-hmm. And I believe that is a city, that is North New Jersey. You know, one thing that happens wrong negates or outshines all of the good that is going on in this city. And I wanted to be a person to help people realize that we can't afford to make that one mistake. We can't afford to show the negativity, because we have a lot of positive things, a lot of things of strength and empowering people here. So we want to make that shine. But first, we have to erase that negativity, man, because all it takes is one thing to go wrong, and then it outshadows all of the good, all of the hard work that you put in, all of the positive walking and moving forward that you've done. It outshadows it. And so, you know, we're just trying to shine over those shadows, man, and erase those negativities. And the things that have done it for me is listening to the right people, listening to my OGs, getting more information, traveling, experiencing, and bringing all of that knowledge back to here, back to the place that I was born at, back to the place, where my seed was nourished at and sowed. So, and that place is Newark, New Jersey, man. So I think those ills and wanting my city to be better and put on the pedestal that it belongs on, you know, and not just Newark, New Jersey, all cities like Newark, New Jersey, all chocolate cities around the country and around the world for that matter, you know, those are the things, just wanting better for those impoverished places or those places who are shunned upon. I want to show all of the good and that there's beauty in all of that, man. And absolutely, I think me noticing the beauty is from me starting to travel. When I started to travel, I started to notice that it was, you know, you can see beauty everywhere, but if it's common to you, if it's every day presented to you, you forget that it's beautiful. It's like meeting a beautiful young lady, a beautiful woman one day, and you gotta have her, you wanna have her, you make her your wife, and then now she's normal to you. It doesn't mean that she lost her beauty, it's just that you're used to it. So I wanted to show people that, you know, the beauty is here and we must recognize it and make the world recognize it, man. Because when you recognize it, the youth recognize it. When the youth recognize it, the new generation recognize it, and they make it better and better and better.
Absolutely, man. You know, that's one thing I was going to ask you coming up later on. We're getting ready to go to commercial break here in about 45 seconds or so. But, you know, being a hip hop artist, you get a chance to travel, of course, the country and the world, and you're able to see different countries and experience different cultures and things of that nature. When we come back, I would like to get, you know, your thoughts on your experiences in other countries. How were your experiences over there? What was the most interesting country you were able to visit and perform in, and what were some of the things that you were able to take back? And also, when we come back from commercials, I want to ask you your efforts. You've been pretty vocal on a lot of things within the communities, not only in your city, in your state, but abroad. You've been vocal about assisting Flint, Michigan with their water
crisis. Yeah.
So I'm going to give you an opportunity to talk about that and so much more. We got Do It All from Lords of the Underground. Toll-free number is 1-877-300-7645. The website is flowofwisdom.com. And also, for those that don't know, this man's resume as an actor is rather lengthy, so we're going to talk about that as well and any other future endeavors he's got going on. His social media, you can follow him on Twitter, Do It All. That's D-O-I-T-A-A-A-L-L-D-U. Same thing on Instagram, Do It All on Instagram. And we'll be back, man, with more with the hip-hop legends. Hey, and real quick, man, before I let you take a break, I was disappointed, man. The first hour, I had Wise Intelligent lined up for the show. It was going to be a Jersey-bound show today.
Oh, man. Shout out to Wise, man. That's a great guy right there.
I know. Unfortunately, man, it was a no-call, no-show. So I hope everything is good with him. But, you know, we'll try to reconnect it. But stay right there. We're going to take a quick commercial break here on Flow of Wisdom Radio.
All right, bro. We here.
Yes, yes, yes. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. This is Flow of Wisdom Radio. I'm your host, Sean Anthony. The website is flowofwisdom.com. I am joined by Do It All, Duke Kelly, one third of the legendary platinum hip hop group Lords of the Underground, actor, film, and TV producer. 211 Media Group and 211 Community Impact is his nonprofit organization. And, you know, before the break, I was talking to you about Flint. You've been very vocal on your social media about helping out Flint, Michigan. Talk about your efforts and what you're doing to support those people up there with their water crisis.
Well, I mean, we've all heard nationally about what's going on in Flint, Michigan, about the water supply that is being supplied mainly to your impoverished neighborhoods, so to speak. And, it's just a shame, man. It's just a shame that, you know, water is life. You know, water is life. And if you don't have water in your communities, then how can you survive? How can you, you know, live? And the water in Flint, Michigan, the amount of lead and the amount of contamination that's going into people's homes, it's somebody should be held accountable for that. And I want to help them out, and we have to come in solidarity and help them out because our water situation here in New Jersey, in Newark, East Orange, you know, and cities like that is not the greatest as well. Mm-hmm. So Newark, New Jersey is just a minute away from being what Flint, Michigan is right now. You never know. We might need their help. So I just look at it as our brotherly cities, our sisterly cities. If we don't help each other in our communities, then we're really doomed. You know, so they need our help right now, and that's what we're doing, man. We just coming together trying to give them some assistance any way we can. And what we're doing here with the help along of Marcy DePena in Newark, New Jersey, who is helping us out, and Kiasa, who is Louis Farrakhan's granddaughter. She came together and did the hip-hop for Haiti when Haiti had their earthquake and all of that. She was the one who helped out. So she asked for us to get together. We have 47 cities now who are trying to raise $80,000. And we're getting close, man. And the $80,000, salute to everybody who's been dropping off water in Flint, Michigan. That's cool. But, you know, you're dropping off water in plastic bottles and if people don't drink it, then that water will become contaminated as well.
Right.
So what we're doing is we're buying filtration systems and going into I believe 8,000 homes in Flint, Michigan. Now, I'm not saying that it's the end all to be all, but it's a start.
Yeah.
You know, 8,000 homes with filtration systems, and we actually went to Flint and had a filtration system that we're buying put into a home to test it out to see how it would react. And even those that we are buying will only last for a year and six months. So the main problem is that Flint, Michigan has to change the pipes.
Right.
Just like Newark, New Jersey has to change the pipes. These pipes have been here for, you know, decades.
Right.
And they have lead in them. So, I mean, you can keep trying to clean the water and cleanse the water, but the situation is you need to change the pipe. So we're just trying to give our system assistance, man, and showing the city that's down right now that they have people behind them to help. And we just coming together and doing what we can as a people, man. That's all.
That's great, man. That is great. You know, this is a short segment, so you know, when we come back, we'll have a lot more time. But you know, talk about like your career. Of course, you're still putting out music today, and also other media projects. But you know, at the height of your career, the height of Lords of the Underground, you know, from that time when you guys were, you know, on the charts and touring and everything like that, like, when did you start to shift your career and going in the direction that you're in now with your 211 Media Group and all the and the acting that you've been doing?
Well, I think the shift happened for me when we first came out with Lords of the Underground. You got to realize I was a young man, I was a teenager, so to speak, and when I was traveling, you know, I come from a poverty area in Newark, New Jersey, like a lot of our hip hoppers. And when I started to make the shift, I was traveling. And I noticed that when I would go to Paris or I would go to these cities that were historic or considered one of the wonders of the world, that I wasn't indulging and taking in all of the information that was right there in front of me. These are things that we've seen in our history books. These are things that we see on postcards and television shows and in libraries. And I wasn't embracing it. I would go to Paris and I would be in this historical place and I would stay in my hotel room or go to a restaurant, go to sound check, do the show, maybe go to an after party, back to the airport, and I'm gone.
Hang on, dude. We got to take a quick commercial break. We'll come right back with more after this on Flow of Wisdom Radio. Sorry to cut you off, brother. All right, the toll-free number is 1-877-300-7645. We are live, Flow of Wisdom Radio. I'm your host, Sean Anthony, and I'm joined by one-third of the legendary platinum hip-hop group Lords of the Underground, Do It All. Duke Kelly is joining us.
Yes, sir.
You posted something last week on your Facebook page. It was a clip of the interview with Waka Flocka on The Breakfast Club, which I love that interview, by the way, but on your post, you said, it's good to hear this brother talk like this. Hip hop is growing up. Travel will change your mindset. And yeah. I can personally attest to that, man. I just came back a few weeks ago from Abu Dhabi. I cannot put it in words how impactful that trip was for me. It definitely changed my mindset personally. But we were talking before the commercial break. You were saying earlier in your career, you were traveling to Paris and all of these different countries, you know, historical places, and you really wasn't taking it all in at that moment. So can you finish what you were saying and then, you know, bring it up to how you got that shift in your career to, you know, putting you in the place that you're in now?
Yeah, I think when you come from, I mean, for me, I can't speak for everybody, but I know when I was first getting on, coming from Newark, New Jersey, coming from the inner city and traveling these places, I thought that it was just supposed to happen. I just thought that it was just meant to be, you know, and I wasn't really appreciative in the sense that this is not normal. Everybody is not getting these experiences. So you need to take these experiences because experience is education, man, you know. So take these experiences and do something with them. Enjoy them, for one, and use it as a seed to plant in others for the people who can't travel here. You know, give them that insight that you're receiving. And when I started to realize it, I was living in Paris for a little while. My man DJ Lord Jazz was over there for 13 years. And I was walking through the kitchen that had the Eiffel Tower just shining right in the window, and you walk through the living room, and the Eiffel Tower, it flashes about 9 or 10 o'clock at night every night. And I remember stopping and saying, wow, I used to look at this on a postcard. Now I'm looking out my window, and it's there, you know. And at that moment when I said that, I said, okay, here I am noticing beauty that are all the way across the world. So why can't I notice this same beauty in the place that I'm from? And what made me say that is because I had a visitor that visited me, came from Switzerland, and he came up here to visit me, and he would walk around and look at the things that I would see every day and say, oh, that's beautiful, or wow, look at that, or look how that looks, that's amazing. And I'm seeing these things every day, and it made me go, okay, here it is. We have beauty in our eyes every day. But since we see it, it becomes a normality to us. It becomes normal. So we don't appreciate it as people who don't get a chance to view it or see it as often as we do. And I was saying the same thing when I would go to his place or when I would go abroad. You know, so it just made me realize, wow, we have to appreciate the beauty in the things that we have and appreciate the things that we already have and utilize them in, to the best of our knowledge and you know, just make people aware that these things are they're here for us, man. You know what I mean? Like, these things are a beauty that, you know, I guess what I'm trying to say is when you have something in your possession, you know, we always want better. We always want more. But we need to utilize the things that we already have before we can receive anything better.
Don't take nothing for granted, basically.
Yeah, don't take anything for granted, man. And that's what I stopped doing. I stopped taking that. I stopped taking my city for granted, and I didn't really think I was. But by me, you know, having NJ or Nook on my hats or my clothing and all of that, but not really doing anything else to make, you know, like, I'm wearing all of this on the stage and doing all of that, but what am I really truly giving back? I'm claiming that this city made me and I love this city, but how am I professing my love to this city? Just by saying its name, just by wearing something on my shirt, what am I really implementing back into the youth and to the people and to the way of life of this city, you know? So that's what I started doing, man, you know. And just from traveling, it just broadened my horizons and made me understand. And like you said, take nothing for granted at all.
Right. Switching gears again, man. On your Instagram, you posted a picture of a distant shot of your family at a funeral. And you wrote, quote, it says, "It wasn't the greatest reason for a family to meet up, but it was an amazing time bonding and reassuring our love for each other. My family members asked me to speak at my cousin's funeral yesterday, and I didn't know what I would say or talk about. After hearing everyone, from family to friends and loved ones, stories about him, I decided to speak on gun violence by the hands of black on blacks and how it destructs our people and our communities. I also spoke about love, respect, and attachment." And a plethora of hashtags in this. You said, "If you currently have a problem with someone, like a family member, friend, loved one, call them today and talk about it. Work it out, because tomorrow is not promised. Peace and love." Wow. First of all, man, I want to say I'm sorry for your loss, because I understand that this wasn't that long ago. But,
yeah, no doubt, man.
But are you willing to share some of those words and thoughts that you shared that sad day to your family, to some of my listeners here?
Yeah, I'm willing, man. I put it on the social media, so, you know, I'm willing to share it, man. You know, it's just, you know, shout out to my cousin, man, because it's just like, you know, a lot of times, you know, family, I know in my family, family is a intricate situation. It could be a difficult situation at times, because here are people that you love, but if you have an issue with them, you go hard with them. I'm just starting to realize when you love somebody and something happens, you take it to heart. Like if you get into a disagreement or a situation with them, and the reason why you go so hard and you take it so hard is because of the love, because of how you feel about them. Because if you didn't care about somebody, if you didn't, you know, if you didn't have an understanding with somebody or whatever, would you really care what somebody is saying about you? Would it really even matter? But when it's somebody that you care about, when you love, and you have these discrepancies, you know, you really feel like, man, because you're hurt, or you don't understand why family doesn't love you, or you love them as you do, you know? So I was just saying, you know, I was just kind of watching my family and not to put all my personal business out there, but just little discrepancies within the family. Of course, everybody loves each other, but little discrepancies that keep you away, keep distance in between you. And when death happens, it brings everybody together. So I was saying, this is not a great situation that brought us together, but it did bring us together. It allowed us to talk. It allows us to understand each other more. you know, listen to each other, and then you realize that it's really all petty. Mm-hmm. You know, it's really small. If you're calling each other family, if you are family, then it's really all small. And that the love that you have for each other that caused you to cause the distance because you love them so much, you know, love is stronger than all of that pettiness, all of the little misunderstandings. And it had to take the death of an individual, of a family member, to bring us together to realize that. So I was saying, if you have a problem with anybody in your family, anybody that you consider a loved one or anything, just talk to them. Because it might be just as simple as just a conversation and understanding each other, allowing each other to hear each other out, to understand. And for me, man, you know, I learned when I listen to people, I can understand better. I listen to them and I comprehend and I say, wow, I see how you were looking at it. Mm-hmm. And hopefully you can see how I was looking at it. And it's not even that deep, man. I think that, you know, family and loved ones and people in your corner is important. If you don't have that, then you probably don't have anything. And, you know, one thing that I did put up a little while ago, too, is I lost my biological father, who I didn't have a relationship with, about maybe 6 months ago. And he had nobody at his funeral, right? Wow. He had nobody, like literally one person, which was his current girlfriend. And I just looked at that to say, wow, this man died with nobody loving him. Like literally maybe just one person who was his current girlfriend. So my thinking was, if a man dies alone, what did he really leave on this planet? Like, what contribution did he leave? Because he sure didn't leave love behind. He didn't leave anybody that respected him or loved him. I said to myself, I don't want to die like that. I don't want to die with nobody not loving or caring that I'm even going. Even though it's only our physical shell and all of that type of stuff. Right. You know, I said too that I don't wish any. You know, I hope that if he comes back or if it's reincarnation or whatever, however you look at it, or heaven, hell, whatever you look at, that in the next life, his soul and his spirit has learned lessons from this life that he can do better in the next, whatever that is. Because for a man to die with no one loving you, right, that means that, you know, like, wow. Like what contribution did you leave on this planet Earth, man?
Well, I will say, man, I mean, that's powerful what you're saying. And I will just say to you, man, be encouraged, because what you're doing, you're breaking that cycle. Whatever your father did, you know what I'm saying, or didn't do, you're definitely changing people's lives. I see it just in the social media, just interacting with you tonight, today. The brief interaction I had with you backstage at that concert a few years ago here in Richmond. I mean, you're making a change, man, and you're shifting the paradigm. And speaking of shifting the paradigm, before we run out of time, let's switch gears here. And thank you for sharing that, man. I really appreciate that. You probably helping someone that's listening to this right now. But let's talk about the politics, man. I mean, what are your thoughts on the entertainment, if you will, with the Republican debate and the Democrats campaigning? You got Killer Mike behind Bernie Sanders and. What are your thoughts on this whole melee? I'm not asking you to tell me who you're voting for or anything like that, but just, you know, your perspective on what you're viewing and what you see.
Man, you know, honestly, just my perspective, I think that white middle America is trying to get back at all the people who voted for Barack Obama.
Oh, okay. Hold on. Hold on. We're going to take a quick break and come right back with that, because I wasn't expecting that response. Do It All from Lords of the Underground, legendary hip-hop group. We're going to take a quick commercial break and come back right after these messages on Floor Wisdom Radio. Back to Floor Wisdom Radio. I am your host, Sean Anthony, live here on the Genesis Communications Network. Toll-free is 877-300-7645. Just having a great conversation with legendary platinum hip-hop group, Lords of the Underground. Do it all. Do Kelly, one-third of the group, Lords of the Underground. And, you know, you just said something. You made a very controversial statement, when I asked about your perspective on the presidential elections going on right now. You said you think white America is trying to get back at everyone that voted for Barack Obama. Is that what you said?
Yeah, man, it's just comedy over there in the Republican Party. You know, I think anytime you talk about politics and religion and all of that, it stirs up the pot.
Right.
But you know, it's just so many things with Donald Trump that is. I mean, he's telling you to his face. One thing I can say about him: the guy is honest.
Right.
He's being honest with you. He's telling you how he feels. He says he doesn't like Muslims. He says he doesn't like Mexicans. He says, you know, he's telling you everything, you know. So it's just, you know, when you kind of change the perspective and you ask little kids the questions of how what if your president like Mexicans, would you vote for him? What if your president likes Muslims, would you vote for him? And you put it, you know, just change the perspective and you ask them different questions. I saw something online that they were asking his fans and his followers questions that Hitler answered, and they just changed it like it was Donald Trump. And they asked him, would you vote for Donald Trump if he felt this way? And they all said yes, but they just really put Donald Trump's name on it, and it really was questions from Hitler. Mm. So you will go with somebody who has the same ideologies as Hitler, for one. You know, it's just crazy, man. This guy, Donald Trump, you know, he's probably a shrewd business guy. Probably. I'm not even going to say probably. He is a shrewd business guy. We all know that from just his movements and his actions. And I think that white America, middle America, believes that he'll be a shrewd businessman for the corporation of the United States of America, you know, because that's all what it really is. You know, the United States of America is a big corporation, and we're the military for the rest of the world. So if you put Donald Trump as the president of the military country of the world, you can guarantee that we will be in World War III instantly. And when you create war, you create new government. You're able to steal the things from people that you weren't able to take from them through legislation or through treaties and all of that type of stuff. So, yeah, of course, white middle America will love for Donald Trump to get in because it does so many things for them, but nothing really for the people who really need to be cared for and to have an understanding in this state. In this country, mm-hmm. You know.
Yeah, well, you know, man, it's unfortunate we're running out of time. So real quick, I just want to say, first of all, congratulations to you. You were just recently selected as one of the instructors for iArts program, and you're going to be teaching 16.
IArts Media, man.
Yeah, you're going to be teaching mm-hmm. 16 to 24 year old young adults everything about entertainment, arts, media, and business of music. Man, I'm just really, really proud of you, man, and what you are doing. And also, real quick, let me just mention your resume. You've appeared in 30 Rock, The Sopranos, New York Undercover, and you've done some independent projects as well. Briefly talk about, because mm-hmm. We're running out of time, talk about 211 Media Group and what some of the projects you're working on now.
Shout out to 211 Media Group. My partner, Eon Haynes, my partner, Dez Fluffman Jones. You know, one thing I got to say, man, you've been giving me a lot of props and things, and I appreciate it. But I'm not the smartest dude at the table. I'm just a part of the whole. I can't do none of this by myself, and I understand that. I know that. Yeah, my name is Do It All, but I've learned as I'm getting older, I can't do it all for real by myself. You know what I mean? And I just have a lot of people who play a lot of different roles, and when we come together, it forms like Voltron. I do what I'm good at. You know what I mean? I do what I know I can do, and you know, and that's being part of the whole. 211 Media Group is where art becomes media. We take anything art and we turn it into media, or we use media to make art shine up amongst the world and present it to the world.
I'm sorry, man. I'm running out of time. My music is queuing, but look, let's stay in contact because that's. I may have some ideas to pitch at you, you know, with your 211 Media Group. But thank you so much for your time. Do it all from Lords of the Underground. Check them out online, guys. Be blessed. This is Floor Wisdom Radio.